Start is 11:15 a.m. So please ignore problem number 3 of homework number 5 because it's a repeat of problem 4 of the previous assignment. So that's my mistake. Sorry. So it's a repeat of the previous. So it's there is no point in doing it. Okay, any question you have? I think today is October 1. Somebody wrote to me last night that the person will see me on September 31st. And I replied back, it will take a long, long time before we meet. Because there is no September 31st, right? Okay. See, if you don't have any questions, what we were doing last time was polar decomposition theorem. And it's really a review of linear algebra. And we will try to see how we can relate it to our continuum mechanics part. So if you have any matrix, and I'm going to write matrix with a tilde underneath, as we have been doing. So instead of saying 3 by 3, I'm just putting F. So this can be written as the product of either R, U, that's what I wrote last time, or it can also be written as VR. So R is same in both cases. But U and V are different. R is a 3x3 matrix, F is a 3x3 matrix, U is a 3x3 matrix. R is same, R is orthogonal, which means R inverse equals R transpose. U is symmetric, that means U equal to U transpose. V is symmetric, V equal to V transpose. And both U and V are positive definite because determinant of F is positive. Both U and V are positive definite, that means all the eigenvalues of U and V are positive. If U is symmetric, eigenvalues are real. Eigenvalues of a symmetric matrix are real. That's a theorem in linear algebra. So therefore, eigenvalues of U and V are real. And since these matrices are positive definite, therefore the eigenvalues are positive. They are positive real numbers. Now C, which we defined as F transpose F, so that will be R U transpose R U, which is U transpose R transpose R U. Because if you take the transpose of the product of two matrices, you get the product of the transpose matrices in the reverse order. So R U transpose is U transpose R transpose. But U transpose is U, and R transpose R is identity matrix because R inverse equal to R transpose. Therefore, so C is U square. So C is U square. And B is FF transpose. That's the way we defined it. So B we defined as FF transpose. And if we go through the same algebra, so we get this as V square. And V R R transpose V transpose. So thus V identity V, thus V square. So F, if F is RU equal to VR, then C is U square and B is V square. Now if you remember, we called C as right Cauchy-Green tensor and we called B as left Cauchy-Green tensor. These three dots mean I did not write the whole thing. It's left Cauchy-Green tensor. Now we can explain why this is left and why this is right. Because in the polar decomposition of F, U appears to the right of R and C is U square, therefore C is called right Cauchy-Green tensor. In this decomposition, U appears to the right, like the right side of R. It's left side and right side. So U appears to the right side of R and C is U square, therefore C is called right Cauchy-Green tensor. The V, it appears to the left of R and B is V square. So B is called left Cauchy-Green tensor. Cauchy and Green, these are two different mathematicians. And as I said earlier, Cauchy is the god or father of classical continuum mechanics. So you will hear the word Cauchy several times. Okay, now what does it physically mean though? So we wrote mathematically this is neat, but what does it physically mean? So physically, it means the following. So we draw our famous potato. So we have this line P, Q. So to apply F, F is the deformation gradient. So what does F do? F takes P, PQ into P prime Q prime. So F takes PQ into P prime Q prime. That's what we have been studying so far, right? That F deforms the line PQ into line P prime Q prime. Now, if we want to use the polar decomposition theorem, what it says is that you can first apply U. So you can first apply U and then apply R. So what U will do, it will take the line P to P double prime and Q double prime. So P stretches as well as rotates a line element in general. P can stretch. When I say stretch, it can contract also. It changes the length of line elements and it changes the angle between line elements. And it also causes rotation. What will R do? See, F is equal to RU. So we applied U, which means we'll have stretched the line PQ and possibly rotated it. Yes? Will you please press it?
R only does the final rotation.
R only does the rotation. Very good. So R does not change the length of line elements. If you rotate a body, like if you rotate this book, the length of a line element is not changed. The angle between two lines is not changed. So it's really U that is causing the strain. R is not causing any change in length or any change in angles. So R is not causing any strain. So R will take this to the final position. We could equally apply R first, because F is equal to RU equal to VR. So we could also apply R first. So what will R do? It will cause only rigid rotation. So it will rotate PQ into P double prime, Q double prime. Actually, this is not necessarily, this line is not the same as the previous one. So it's P triple prime, Q triple prime, just to indicate that this line is different. And then V will cause changes in angles and changes in length of the line element, and also possibly rotation. Okay, so the strains which are associated with changes in lengths and changes in angles between two lines are induced by U and V. R is simply rotating the body. So you can either first strain it and then rotate it, or you first rotate it and then strain it. In small deformations, this is written as rotation plus straining plus. Here it is rotation either pre-multiplied or post-multiplied by straining. Large deformation, it's multiplication, which is somewhat harder. When we were kindergarten, we learned first addition, because that's the easiest thing to do. The multiplication comes next. So here we have matrix multiplication that takes a few more steps. So in large deformation theory, there is no such thing as addition of strains. You have to multiply matrices to get the final strain. Any question about this part?
So U and V, right, they do only stretching, is it, or?
No, they also do rotations. U and V cause stretching, which means changes in lengths of line elements, as well as changes in angle between line elements, as well as rotation. Okay, so furthermore, we are not assuming that F is constant. What does F equal to constant mean? Like if F is constant throughout the body, what is that deformation called? Again, this will be a question on your exam, and we have already talked about it. Yes, you know the answer. No, it's okay. It's good. No, it's okay. It's good. You know it. So, anyone else? We have already talked about it. If F is constant throughout the body, it could be a function of time. So, what is that deformation called?
Homogeneous.
Okay, now we also talked about eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Okay, that was the review we had last time. So the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So let's say we are talking about U, and its one of its eigenvectors is n1. This one with superscript in parentheses is not a component. It's not a component of n. Component of n we have been writing by subscripts. So this is a vector n. Since I don't want to write n, m, l, m, n as vectors, I'm just going to write n1, n2, n3 as vectors. So the eigenvalue means that lambda 1 is the corresponding eigenvalue, and n1 is the eigenvector. Okay. So what will be CN1? Now it's a little bit too much to expect because I just had c equal to u square. So if you don't remember, it's in your notes now. We just proved like few minutes ago that c is u square. U square means it's u n 1. U square means u multiplied by u. So what is this quantity now? So that's lambda 1 n 1. Now lambda 1 is a scalar. So we can take it out. The multiplication is between u and n 1. Lambda 1, we can take it out. So what is u n 1? Well, that's given on the top line. So what we get then is lambda 1 n 1 or lambda 1 square n 1. So that means eigenvectors of u and c are the same. Eigenvectors of u and c are the same. But eigenvalue of c is the square of the eigenvalue of u. Eigenvalues of c are the squares of the eigenvalues of u. Again, basically linear algebra. Now, so what will happen to eigenvalues of v? So we wrote f is equal to ru equal to VR. So if I say RU operating upon N1, RU operating upon N1, N1 is an eigenvector of U. That's so R operating upon u n 1, but u n 1 is lambda 1 n 1 so it's lambda 1 n 1, but lambda 1 is a scalar, it's a number, so we get R n 1 So if n1 is a unit vector, capital N1 is a unit vector, what will be r times n1? Like what will be the length of r n1? And you already answered that question like a little while ago. What does r do to a vector? Francis? It rotates. Okay. So you can press that button. So it rotates.
It rotates.
So what will be the length of Rn1? Same as that of N1. What was the length of N1? Unit. Therefore, the length of Rn1 is unit. So let's call this Rn1 as little n1. Let's call this Rn1 as little n1. Okay, so we are giving a name to it. This Rn1, we are setting it equal to little n1. So what we have done is Ru n1 is equal to lambda 1 n1. I've just copied that line. But this quantity Ru by the polar decomposition theorem is also equal to Vr. Ru is also equal to Vr. Ru is also equal to Vr. Now, this one we already defined. So this is equal to V N1 now read backwards. Say V N1 equals this, equals that, equals that. These are strict equalities, like there is no approximation or anything. It's math. A equal to B equal to C equal to D, therefore A equal to D. So this thing is equal to that, equal to that, equal to that. So what does N1 mean then? Little n1. So little n1 is the eigenvector of, yes, go ahead.
Don't worry about it.
Say. No, it's okay, go ahead.
Little n1 is an eigenvector of V.
And the corresponding eigenvalue is?
The same as it was for the original configuration.
Well, give its name, like speak it out.
Oh,
so it's lambda 1. So what does it mean then? That means the eigenvalues of U and V are same. Eigenvalues of U and V are same. So they are equal to each other. So if you find eigenvalue of U or eigenvalue of V, it makes no difference. So by the same token, eigenvalues of C and B are same. Because C was U square and B is V square, so their eigenvalues are also same. Right? Does it make sense? C matrix is not equal to B matrix. Their eigenvalues are same. They are not identical. I mean, the matrices themselves are not identical. Only their eigenvalues are same. Eigenvalues of U and V are same. Their eigenvectors are not necessarily same. We have to use the word necessarily because in some deformation, it may come out that the eigenvectors of U and V are same. So if the rotation is 1, if there is no rotation of the body, like in a simple tension test. In a simple tension test, there is no rotation. You are constraining the specimen not to rotate. So in that case, R is identity matrix and U equal to V, and therefore eigenvectors of U and V come out to be same. That's if you can produce a simple tension deformation. Okay, now I said this matrices B and C are not same, but what is the relationship between them? So to find the relationship between them, we can say C is F transpose F. C is F transpose F, but F is VR transpose VR. So this is R transpose VR. So this is R transpose BR. So matrices C and B are related through the matrix R. Matrices C and B are related through the matrix R. Now please speak up.
I'm just asking if C and B are similar matrices.
What do you mean by similar?
Similar, generally, similar relation, if I well remember, is similarity is
a similarity relation. It's a similarity relation.
You know, yeah.
And so they are not similar, but they are related by
geometrically way. I mean.
Yeah, they are similarity. There's a similarity relationship between the two. So
we have a question at Wake.
Yeah, sure. Please speak up.
Yeah. When you were talking before about the eigenvalues. We couldn't understand if you were saying C and V or C and B as in boy.
Okay. The eigenvalues of C and B as in boy are the same.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Eigenvalues of U as in uncle and V as in virtual are same. Their eigenvectors are not same.
Does that mean what you wrote down is wrong up top? Because you wrote eigenvectors above.
Where? This is eigenvalues.
Before that.
There I wrote eigenvalues of U and C are same, not C and B. Yeah, eigenvectors of U and C are same. U and C, not C and B. Yeah, U and C are same. Now what I wrote down is correct. Not only I wrote it down, I showed you that they are same. Okay? Any other question? Okay, now what does it physically mean now? So we wrote that U, this is just to remind you, that U N1 is lambda times N1. So I take this body in the undeformed state. My other pens are not doing a very good job, so either I use blue color or I use red color, because black color is not working too well. So I take, at this point P, which is any point, I take three vectors, which are eigenvectors of U. I take three vectors, which are eigenvectors of U. And these eigenvectors can be made mutually perpendicular if they are not mutually perpendicular to start with. So it depends upon the eigenvalues of U. If eigenvalues of U, the three eigenvalues of U are different, distinct, then eigenvectors are uniquely determined and they are mutually perpendicular. If eigenvectors of U are not distinct, which means two of them are equal or all three of them are equal. If two of them are equal, then you can find one eigenvector uniquely. The other two are in a plane perpendicular to the one you found uniquely. And if all three eigenvalues are same, then every vector is an eigenvector of U. And that will be the case if U is equal to some constant times the identity matrix. And that happens if you have hydrostatic compression or tension, then U can be a constant multiplied by the identity matrix. So let's assume eigenvalues of U are distinct. They are different. Okay? If they are say 1, 2, and 3, or 1.1, 2.2, and 3.1. So they are different. Okay? Which means you can find these, and they don't have to be along x1 and y1, along x, y, and z axis. So let me redraw this sketch. So this is 1, 2, and they're all unit vectors. So this is N3. So N1, N2, N3 are eigenvectors of U. So what will happen if I apply U to it? If I apply U to it, what will happen to these eigenvectors N1, N2, and N3? Anyone at Wake Forest, either Ashley or Kathy or Wu? Ashley?
Could you repeat the question?
Okay, n1, n2, n3 are eigenvectors of U. So if we apply U to this body now, what will happen to these eigenvectors n1, n2, n3 we have drawn on the sketch? Like, what will be their deformed positions and lengths?
We don't know.
Okay. See, the first line says un1 equals lambda 1n1. So lambda 1 is the stretch. That tells you how much the length has changed, because n is a unit vector. So the length of these vectors will change, plus they will be rotated. They may be rotated. U causes both stretching as well as rotation, but in this case, you cannot be rotate them because these are eigenvectors. So un1 equals n1. So in this case, sorry, there is no rotation. So this is lambda 1, n1, and this is lambda 2, n2, and this is lambda 3, n3. You cannot rotate the eigenvector because you operating upon n1 gives you a vector parallel to n1. If these were not eigenvectors, then they may have been rotated. And what will R do then? R will rotate these but R will not change the length. So it will become so where n, little n, is R times big N. Where little n is R times big N. So what we are doing is we are saying, what is the result of having f equal to ur? Sorry, f equal to ru. F equal to ru. You first apply u and then you apply r. But if you say f equal to vr, you first apply rotation. So what will R do? R will rotate these vectors into little n1. It will not change the length. So the result will be n1, n2, and n3. And then V will cause their stretching. So we will stretch these line elements. By stretching, I mean contraction also. We will change the lengths of these line elements. So R takes the eigenvectors of U into eigenvectors of V. R takes the eigenvectors of U into eigenvectors of V. So R takes the eigenvectors of U, which we will see in a little while, that those are the directions along which stretches are maximum or minimum. You have talked about principal strains in mechanics of deforms class. So what did you mean by principal strains? What was the definition of, like, if somebody asks you what is a principal strain, so what will you say? Bless you. And that's, of course, not the answer, but so what is a principal strain? You learned that, right? So that's the maximum or minimum axial strain. Okay, that's the maximum or minimum, roughly speaking, change in length per unit length. But it occurs along certain directions. It is not along any direction. and the directions along which these frames are maximum, you call them principal directions. And you use the Mohr circle to find it. I mean, that was one way. Or you had strain transformation equations to find it. But, so before we go there, the question is going to be the following. That's the first homework problem, first problem of homework number 5. Yeah, just let me write this here. Yes.
So normally U stretches and rotates, but if it's an eigenvector, it can only stretch.
Right. Both U and V normally rotate and stretch. But if we are talking about eigenvectors, by definition, the end result has to be a vector parallel to the eigenvector. That's the definition of an eigenvector. Okay, so the problem, the first problem says you are given a deformation F, or you are given a deformation from which you can find F, and find R and U. Find the rotation and the stretch tensors. Like right stretch tensor. I don't know whether it asks you to find left stretch tensor also or not, but it's a procedure is same. So what you do is you find C first from F. So you find C, that's F transpose F by definition. Find eigenvectors and eigenvalues of C. Find eigenvectors and eigenvalues of C. Where lambda 1 is the eigenvector of, eigenvalue of U, so I wrote lambda 1 square here. It's positive. It's a positive number. Well, lambda 1 square is, of course, positive because you are squaring something. Okay, so you, all of you have Mathematica, MATLAB. So if you give C and ask it to find eigenvalues, eigenvectors, it will spit it out. So no big deal now. In my days, of course, we had to do by hand. But now it's no problem. So it will spit out the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues. So actually it will probably do, it will most likely find R and U also, but I don't know. Okay, so what you do then is, so you write C in the matrix as P lambda P transpose, where P, the matrix P is N1, this pen doesn't write well, so it's N11, N12, N13, N12, N22, N32, N13, N23, N33. So P is the matrix of the components of eigenvectors of C. P is the matrix of the components of eigenvectors of C. N1, N2, N3 are eigenvectors of C. And then these are the, this is matrix of the components. Is it making sense? Then U, which is square root of C, the square root of C does not equal square root of C11, square root of C12, square root of C13. The square root of a matrix is not equal to the square root of its components. So then U will be equal to P square root of lambda. Oh, I forgot to give you the definition of lambda. So lambda is diagonal matrix lambda 1 square, lambda 2 square, lambda 3 square. It's a diagonal matrix, lambda 1 square, lambda 2 square, lambda 3 square. Okay. So square root of lambda then. Is it clear? The definition of lambda is clear. That one we have here. These are the eigenvalues of C. And the square root of a diagonal matrix equals the square root of the diagonal elements. Square root of a diagonal matrix, diagonal, equals the square root of the diagonal elements. So the square root of lambda is then just lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. And that's what goes in here. Okay? And once you have U, you can find R, because R is F U inverse. So you should be able to complete actually all the homework problems now. Okay? So if my best guess is that this exercise is useless, because if you use Mathematica or MATLAB and say find the square root of matrix C, it will probably find it out for you. However, you still have to find C, and then you find U as square root of C. So you may not have to go through this exercise, because MATLAB or Mathematica may have a built-in function to find the square root of a matrix. But if they do not have, then this is the procedure to use. So you first find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and then find the square root of the eigenvalues, and then U is P, square root of lambda, P transpose. Once you know U, then you know R is F U inverse. Yes, please press that.
Just in terms of semantics, why not call lambda squared up in the C definition, and then when you get down to the new definition, it becomes big lambda again and everything. You don't have square root signs and things are consistent.
Well, then, sure, so I could have said lambda squared here, right? Yeah, sure. Okay, and there's a solved problem in the book also. Like, same thing, which says, if you are given F equal to R, U, find, if you are given F, find U and R. And so procedure is just outlined here. Now, let's go to principles. We still have time. Because Francis was looking at the watch. Okay. So we are at our famous point P. This is our baby, right? We always talk about P. And now the exercise is different. The exercise is that we deform the body F by F to the new shape. So this is reference configuration, and this is deformed configuration. Okay? At point P, we are looking at point P only. At point P, we want to find that direction along which stretch is maximum or minimum. Is my question clear? At point P, there are infinitely many unit vectors, right? You can draw any unit vector you like at point P. Along which unit vector is the stretch maximum or minimum? Okay, so that's what we are shooting for. We want to find the direction along which the stretch is maximum or minimum. I cannot answer whether it will be maximum or minimum before we find them, but it's one of the two. Okay, so since we don't know it, let's say it is along this line, PQ. And that's unit vector along PQ is F. This n has nothing to do with what we have been talking about n before. This n has nothing to do. It is a unit vector along which stretch is maximum or minimum. So what will be ds over big ds square along this line n, unit vector n we are talking about? And we have studied this long time ago. Well, when I say long time ago, probably Monday of last week. And of course, you have used it. You have solved problems. Actually, I forgot to bring your homework. It's graded, but I forgot to pick it up. So I will bring it on Friday. Okay, so what is ds over big ds square? Like the stretched square. What is the change in, what is the final length over initial length square along the line, along the unit vector n? It's too hard. Okay, so if you don't remember it, then let's write the p prime q prime equals its ith component equals FIA evaluated at point P times NA DS, that is PQ, right? PQ is the length times unit vector. So what is then DS square? So that will be P prime Q prime I, P prime Q prime I. So that's F I A N A D S F I say B N B D S. This B is index B, not the right Cauchy-Green tensor or left Cauchy-Green tensor. I was going to put L, but I did not put L. Okay? So, if you multiply F, this I index summation means these two matrices are multiplied. But the index I does not come next to each other, so it's F transpose F. And that we wrote was CAB, NA, NB, DS square. So what we need to maximize or minimize is CAB, NA, and B. That's the ratio of final length square over initial length square. So that's stretch square. However, we can only find those unit vectors. N is a unit vector, so we cannot take n arbitrarily. There's a constraint on n. The constraint on n is that n a must be 1. So we have to stay on that unit sphere. Because NA equal to 1 means N has to be unit vector. So we have to find a unit vector, not any N. So the exercise is find a unit vector N such that this quantity is maximum or minimum. Okay? The exercise is find a unit vector N such that CAB, NA, NB is either maximum or minimum. It's not that boring. Some of you are looking at a clock. I will quit. Okay, but before I quit, I need to ask you to review something. because we need that result, and you should have studied that before. So if I have a function of x, y, and z, and I want to find a point where this function has a maximum or a minimum value, how do we do it? Find the point. So you are given f of x, y, z equal to x cube plus e to the power y plus tangent hyperbolic z minus 30 x, y, z. And the exercise is find the point x, find the coordinates of the point x, y, and z at which this function is either maximum or minimum.
Derivative?
Yes, very good. But can you expand on that?
No.
Huh? Yeah, okay.
You then make them equal to zero, right? And then find critical points.
So you set delta f over delta x equal to zero, delta f over delta y equal to zero, delta f over delta z equal to zero. So this will give you three equations to solve for three unknowns.
Should the second derivative be checked also to see if it is a
to see if it's maximum or minimum? Okay, but that we have not reached that stage yet. However, our exercise is not that. Our exercise has a constraint on it. You cannot find any xyz. You have to find only those xyz's which lie on a sphere or in a certain plane. There's a constraint. So the constraint, supposing the constraint is x square plus y square plus z square minus 1 equal to 0. How do we do the problem now? Find those xyz's which lie on this sphere and for which f is maximum or minimum. So if you have not learned it, go to Google or Wikipedia or Yahoo and type in Lagrange multiplier. You will get probably 1 million entries or hits. Go through one or two of them and you will see what this Lagrange multiplier means. Lagrange is a mathematician. He was a mathematician. So we will pick it up from here next time. And I will ask you how many hits you got when you type this word.
What is the superscript?
It's just a name. See, instead of calling, like your name is Fred, and when you will have a child, you will call it Fred second. You will be a different person, right? So you say, this is a vector n. Then you say, I'm talking about second eigenvalue, and second eigenvalue, you just say, change 1 to 2.
Okay. So it's implied that anywhere that you have the 1, 2, 3.
No, these are not, no, that I will indicate by